are you gonna say everything?
I don't know what is it. Oh, yeah, see, I've never. You can say it. Do you want this?
Sure. Good afternoon. Thanks for coming. Really appreciate you coming. Before I introduce our speaker, Mercy Davison, I would like to tell you a little bit, well, introduce you to the president of SAGE, S-A-G-E, which is the Student Alliance for Greener Environments, a new student group, and they are hosting this talk by Mercy Davison, and I would like to introduce Wendy Ferguson, the president, and she's going to say a few words about the organization before I introduce Mercy.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. A little bit about our organization. We decided that the environmental awareness on this campus was an area where we could improve. And so last fall, we decided to start an organization. We went through the process, got everything situated, and we are slowly gaining momentum. We are probably on an average 10 members every meeting now. Our latest event on Monday night, the Earth Rave, we had more than 25 people there at the event, and so we are gaining momentum. Part of our mission is to raise awareness and to help educate about the environmental issues facing the EC community and the community at large. And so to that end, we have so far done a prescription drug drop-off day where we helped get over 35 pounds worth of prescription drugs out of landfills. They were properly disposed of through the EPA's incinerator down in Texas. We did that in cooperation with the Pre-Med Society and with Roanoke Pharmacy. And then this week has been a very busy week for SAGE. We started out on Saturday with an aluminum can drive to recycle aluminum cans, but also as our fundraiser. Sunday, we planted the flower bed at Pritchard with all native flowers with the idea of helping to bring in more biodiversity through beneficial insects, namely butterflies and bumblebees. And then Monday night was our Earth Rave, where we did a slight or short presentation on vampire energy and then had fun. And then the highlight of our week is tonight's talk, and we are thrilled to have Ms. Davison here. And as a token of our appreciation, we'd like to give her one of our EC Squared t-shirts, and that, which,
really nice.
Which will be available for sale out in the lobby after this talk. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Wendy. And those shirts are only $10, and you'll notice that they have the continents and the sea, the wrong colors. But when Mike Tolliver saw it, he said, well, that makes sense. You're changing the world, which I thought was good. Thanks, Mike. So I'm not going to draw this out, but Mercy's one of my favorite people. She's one of the first people that my husband and I met when we came to Illinois. And at that time, she was juggling her current job as town planner of the town of Normal, Illinois, was also juggling a job of just having had two small boys, and was also juggling the job of being the wife of an organic farmer out in the country. So she was doing it all with perfect aplomb and just very inspiringly so, which she kind of just one of those people that can do everything like that. So she's going to tell you about what she does, but she's basically the go-to green person in Normal, and Normal's winning all sorts of awards. They just recently won one that she's going to talk about from the EPA in their smart growth division, which is pretty exciting, especially for the Midwest and for Central Illinois. And with that, welcome, please, Mercy Davison.
Okay. All right. I'm going to try to get myself hooked up here. Uh,
Okay, the first thing we're going to do is, like before I really talk too much, is we're going to show a video so that the person in the booth can do that and be done with it. Okay, so this is a video that was made by the US EPA. The town won an award last year. It was like the US EPA Smart Growth Award for Best Civic Space. And that would be like best civic space in the whole country. And there were, the EPA gives out like 5 Smart Growth Awards every year. And, you know, one was like to the best small town effort that, and all these awards are for things that have strong sustainability and livability components. So there was a small town award. There was an urban neighborhood revitalization project in St. Louis that was really cool, and other such awards. And then we won the best civic space for our Uptown Circle, which is a traffic circle plus more. So the US EPA made this sweet video, which never in a million years could anyone like me create this sort of thing. But now I get to dog and pony it all over the place. And so we can all benefit from this video. And it just kind of gives you an idea of what's going on in Uptown. Hit it. I just wanted to say that.
The initial problem is we had 5 streets that coming into this one focal point. And there was no real good way to handle all that traffic. But it was the traffic engineers that sort of came up with the idea of the circle. A federal and state road officials required initially was that people not be allowed in the center of the circle.
Oh. No. I don't know what you're talking about.
And that was a battle we fought, and we eventually prevailed. And thank goodness. Can you imagine this place with just, you know, concrete or even just grass here with no people? It's just, I mean, it's boring.
We just rode our bikes down to the roundabout. This has become the hub of what's known as Uptown Normal with all the kind of shops and just quaint, unique places. So
yeah, I work right here, so I see you guys every Tuesday. Yes.
We really didn't ride down here. But as soon as this was built, it kind of drew us here.
Thank you.
With her, it's a good place for her to hang out, and then usually we go and get some ice cream.
And I think it's the water element, more than anything else, that's really made this space what it is and really made it so attractive to so many different people. They come here and they enjoy the beauty, but they also don't know that this actually is a functional water purification system. We're capturing storm water that's being generated in the area from buildings and from streets. We're cleaning it, and then we're using it to irrigate all this beautiful landscaping here. And we actually encourage people to be in the water. That's what it's all about. We want you to enjoy it and play with it and dangle your feet in the water on a hot summer day. And you said there were some dogs in the water. That's fun too.
How old are they?
You ready?
That's music to our ears. The passenger rail element has been so important to this project. The Midwest High-Speed Rail Initiative connecting Chicago and St. Louis is right there.
The area around it has developed, some of which was already in progress at the time and some of which I think continues.
At any one time, the transportation center behind us, that in and of itself has probably created 400 to 500 new jobs.
Thank you. You see it around us tonight. It gives people an opportunity to come to a central spot and relax, socialize, and kind of feel like they're a part of the community.
It's really, the design celebrates the people. And I think that's what makes this really successful, is that it celebrates the people and it focuses your attention on the people that are here. Yet it's beautiful, and people, you know, it creates, I think, a beautiful, attractive place where people want to spend time, and it's memorable.
that was our award. And it was a really big honor, and I don't know that that'll happen again in my professional career. I happened to start at the town about 10, 11 years ago when there was some new thinking going on. And so that this slideshow is going to talk about, we'll talk about why the town of Normal started looking at sustainability and really how the lessons you can learn from Normal can apply anywhere. I mean, the thing you should take away from this is that Normal's just like anywhere else. We're not Portland, we're not Seattle, we're not Berkeley, we're not that hip. we're just not. Which is good news for you, because there are only a handful of those kinds of places in the world, you know? And they, that's great for them, but they're not a good example for a lot of other places. I mean, when I, the first couple years I worked at the town, I learned very quickly that when I was trying to convince people to do something, I shouldn't use Portland as an example. I mean, or Madison, oh my gosh, don't even try that, you know, because they're practically communists up there, right? I mean, people are very sensitive to this stuff, and they're like, those people are nothing like us, so that is an irrelevant example. So when you see things about Normal, just keep that in mind. I mean, it's a pretty regular place. It's fairly conservative elected officials, but clearly they've had the vision to do what I'm going to show you, and it's really because it just made sense to them on many levels. You know, there's not some like known ideology in Normal that it's all about being sustainable. That really isn't. It's part of a much bigger picture, which I think is good news. So it did all start about in 1999 or 2000 when the town had just recently become debt-free, which for a municipal government is a huge deal. I mean, most are not debt-free. But Normal had been very fiscally conservative and paid down all of its debt. And so there was this breathing room, this time where people could step back and say, well, you know, now what do we do? Because that was a really big deal. And they started looking around the community. And I wasn't there at the time. So this is kind of the story I've heard a million times, that somebody said, well, what about downtown Normal? At the time, it was called downtown. And, you know, it was languishing, just like many, many, many central business districts in smaller cities, small towns all across America in the 60s. 70s, the malls came in, the malls located on the outskirts of town and sucked a lot of the life out of the middle. And so Normal was not unique. I mean, we had a fairly low-key downtown area, a lot of empty retail space. It wasn't performing to the level that local government wants. I mean, if you have this historic little center, it's never going to get built that way again. And it's in a geographic location that can't be duplicated. It's right next to the university. Or like here, it's right next to the college and to the courthouse. I mean, that stuff doesn't get built anymore. It's you work with what you have. So Uptown Normal wasn't ever like a big architecturally significant place. We don't have the great buildings that they have in Bloomington, but it's still special enough. So everybody realized it really wasn't doing what it should be doing for the community. So they put out a request and just said, hey, let's do something about downtown Normal. And Doug Farr out of Chicago came back with a plan that they really loved. And he convinced them that focusing on sustainability was really, really important. And why is that? Because it sets you apart. It makes your community just a little different from everybody else. At the time, you know, in 2000, even fewer people were talking about this stuff. So we've never been cutting edge, you know, I'm not going to lie to you. But we were certainly ahead of the curve when it comes to some of these issues in communities that are like us. So Doug said, you know, first of all, you start with the center of your community, and that's just sustainable right off the bat, because that part of town's already been completely screwed up from an ecological perspective. I mean, there's nothing left that you could really do there. You know, it's paved already. Any endangered species that was ever there has been long gone. So the ultimate sustainable project is in a site that's already disturbed and paved. And it's also a site that's already near all sorts of housing, all sorts of people who can walk and bike there. It's right next to all the bus lines, so you're not having to expand out farther into the cornfields. So there's this inherent sustainability about redevelopment and restoration and things like that. He convinced them that the sustainability was going to set Normal apart, and that's really important in this environment. You know, are you just anywhere USA, or are you something a little different? And the fact that Illinois State University is right there just makes it all that much more of a perfect idea. I mean, you have a lot of thinkers over there, a lot of people who are interested in change, and so it worked together really well. And so this big sustainability components in Uptown Normal, which, you know, this much of this isn't like, you're not going to be able to transfer these ideas right to Eureka College or even to the small town of Eureka, but you can scale them down. And so if you look at Uptown, this is back in the day when there were actually still two active rail lines. We had the the North-South rail line, Illinois Central, and then the Chicago-Alton, which is still active. That's the one that is the high-speed rail now. Or it's been upgraded, but the trains aren't in yet. So this is basically where all those streets came together, and it was just a really awkward intersection, and that's where the traffic circle is now. And this was the original plan. You know, most plans start out as pastel. The world is better looking in pastel, or at least it was in the early 2000s. They may be using different colors now, but this is the kind of thing an architect or a planner is going to draw you that's really beautiful. You probably have Eureka College master plans that may be identical. This could be your plan, for all I know. I mean, it all kind of looks like this. But it gives you an idea of, here's the central feature. You need something to focus on. And the thing that I like to tell people about the traffic circle is that, you know, in central Illinois, in most cases, we have to build something special because we don't have it. There isn't a lake in Normal. There's no river. There's no mountain. There's nothing. We got nothing. And so if we spent an extra $1.25 million probably on the roundabout to make it pretty and functional and attractive, but it's doing its job. People flock there. And had we not done it, there was nothing there. We don't even have a courthouse. I mean, at least you have a beautiful courthouse. So you do have to think about, you know, when people will challenge that, like, is it worth it? Like, should, in tough economic times, should you spend $1 million extra on that? And I think this was definitely the right decision, and it's a hard decision for people in decision-making positions to make. I'm not that person. I don't have to tell my constituents that I voted on spending $1 million. But as a staff person, we have to give them a good reason to do it, and we have to explain to them why this is the right thing for the community. And I think every time I go out there and there are just tons of people in Uptown Normal, I feel like it was a right decision, you know, but it was a nail biter. I mean, right towards this plan was on paper for like 7 years before it got built. And boy, right at the end was when the economy just went right into the tank. And it was reasonable for leaders to suddenly start backpedaling a little bit, like, well, maybe this isn't such a good idea right now. And it came down to a vote where we were all, the staff in the audience, we were like, what are they going to say? I mean, we don't know. And so it did pass, and it's been built, and I think it's a really big success. But it can be scary to make those sorts of decisions. What the circle actually does, which is really pretty interesting, is that, I mean, you know that when it rains, the rain just hits the ground, the buildings, the cars, whatever, the gas station property. It just like literally washes all that crud right into the storm sewer and then right into the creek. There's no treatment of this stuff. It's totally unregulated. And I think in our lifetime that'll change. It's already starting to change where the Clean Water Act is starting to catch up with this as a big issue. I mean, when the Clean Water Act first came in, it was easy to pick out the major industrial players and say, you are polluting in this way, you are polluting in that way, you need to stop that. You need to put in some device to fix those obvious problems. Well, now we're looking at things like, I mean, we've kind of done that. Now you look at an entire community, and cumulatively, all the waste we are just pouring right into the creeks is pretty staggering. So in this case, a lot of the water that hits the ground in Uptown actually just goes into the storm sewer like it usually would, but it goes into a cistern under the roundabout. And the cistern, just a big holding tank, it's actually an old sewer pipe that we, you know, everything in Uptown is like 100 years old, just like here. Everything in the Midwest is about 100, 150 years old. And this is like infrastructure that nobody's really fixed in a long time. So, but here it was, this big pipe, 750 feet of pipe that we could have just filled in, or we could have just kind of left it there when we put in all of our new pipes. But we decided, hey, we'll use this leftover piece of pipe that's already in the ground, and we'll just cap it off on the ends and call it a cistern. So the water just goes in there and sits, and then it gets funneled through a couple of very simple separating devices, which separate out like trash and debris, oils, things that float to the top just get skimmed off. And then that water gets pumped up into the water feature that you saw people like dangling their feet in. The outer ring is actually has plants in it that like water. Water-loving plants. What is that? Are they philic? They're not phobic. They're waterphilic. They're hydrophilic. Anyway, see, I'm talking to actual scientists. That's scary. But it goes through those plants, and then it gets pumped into the middle feature, which is really just pretty. And it's like a ripply surface, so it makes a nice little noise, and it's just been really great. So it's funny, that video, you know, it's close to right, but it's not like the most accurate thing ever. Like, I would not personally call it a water purification system. I mean, this is not drinkable water, and it certainly is much cleaner than any other stormwater in town. And no, we don't test it. We don't have any scientists on staff or anything, but it would be very cool. It'd be a very cool project. But there are people who assume, I think, that maybe it's like fountains where they're pumping potable water through it, you know, just like regular water. And so we've even seen people in the middle, this circle in here, this is kind of deep right there. It's like maybe 2 or 3 feet deep. And we've seen people in there with their kids, like in floaty devices, like they're little like huggy, like swimmers. And then like, they're just like dunking them in there. And I think, wow. I mean, that's cool. I'm all about germs and my kids do all sorts of terrible things, but I wasn't expecting to see that. And every year, some kind college student has donated fish to the roundabout. And those fish are very beloved among the children of Normal. Everyone comes to see the fish. The first year we lived there, every couple days we had to go to Uptown Normal to check on the fish, which is another thing that attracts people. I mean, because really sustainability, a huge component of sustainability is making people love it. I mean, if people don't love it, then who's going to sustain it? Who cares, you know? But people love this. They really love it. And I have to say, the fish help. And every year, the anonymous student has then identified themselves and said, I'm worried about the fish that I put in there illegally back in April. And we think, well, come get them. So it's been fun for everybody. But that was an unexpected little addition to the fountain. And it's been a little interesting for the scientists. We now have fish pooping in the water. And what does that do to your nutrient levels? It messes them up. And I don't know how to fix it. You know, there's like algal blooms, and then it's like, well, do you put chemicals in it? You don't want to do that, and you know, blah, blah, blah. So it's like a little science experiment. And we don't have time for that. We do not want, our public works guys are not interested in a science experiment. But it's been really fun. So I say, of course, they all curse me. So this is just what's happening underground, and I do not expect you to be able to read this, but basically you've got all sorts of good stuff as shown by circles and squares under the ground. So there's a cistern. There's some sort of mechanical vault where the public works guys disappear every couple days. They go down there. I don't think they're playing cards. They're actually doing something very important. And then there's some more detention over here. You know, it's interesting. As big as a cistern looks, it is never big enough. Like if you've ever tried to collect water off your roof in a rain barrel or something, who's done that? Anybody? Rain barrels? I mean, you would need so many rain barrels. It's cool. It's totally cool to do it. But boy, even when it looks like a little bit of rain, water accumulates. Water takes up a lot of room. So our cistern is not nearly big enough, but you live and learn. So here's what it looks like. This is a day when there weren't many people there. I'm not sure why. I cannot tell you why. This is an unusually quiet day. It actually looks very pretty out, too. Maybe the students were gone. That's what I think. The students are gone, and nobody else in town knows that they're gone yet, so they're still afraid to come to Uptown. No. I'm just kidding. We love the students. This is an interesting thing, and you could do this on campus. You could do this anywhere. This is a very interesting way to plant trees in an urban environment. So, like, how happy is a tree when it's planted in the sidewalk? Not very happy. And partly that's because they just build the sidewalk like they always do, put some sand, some gravel, put on the concrete on top, and then they just build a concrete. They call it a vault. I mean, like, you should never plant a tree in something called a vault, I mean, on principle. But so you just stick the tree in there with the soil, and then over time, the soil compacts. The tree never grows to be a fully mature tree. It dies early. You're always replacing them. So this system is pretty sweet. It basically puts this structure under the whole sidewalk. So if the whole sidewalk is like here or even a street, this sidewalk is just as strong as any other sidewalk, but underneath you put this like, kind of like this Rubik's cube, like where all the spaces are empty, and then you fill it with this engineered soil, which is just extra fluffy, and you plunk your tree in the middle, and then it gives the tree all sorts of room for its roots to grow. Happy roots, happy tree, big tree. Hopefully trees you don't replace every 7-10 years, you know, because the whole point in an urban environment is that an urban environment is inhuman. I mean, this is not a nice, hard surfaces aren't what we really like evolved to live with. And so you put trees and plants in and suddenly it softens it up. It makes it more livable. It makes it more human. It cleans the air. It sucks up stormwater. I mean, these are working plants here. And by doing it right with this kind of planting strategy, you can really have the trees do a lot more of what they're supposed to do. And this is a company out of Toronto. And we were like maybe the second place in the country to use this. And which is pretty cool to be able to say that. I mean, I don't know. And it makes so much sense. I show this to people on campuses. I talk to people on campus quite a bit. And they're like, yeah, that makes a lot of sense, especially in high traffic areas where you have lots of people trampling all over what would be where the roots are. But if you have them growing in this safe environment, You get the tree, you get the roots, you get to walk all over the place. It's good. Definitely costs more up front, but it's not like astronomical. And if you're not replacing the trees all the time and you're getting the benefit out of the tree that you intended in the first place, then over time, it makes perfect sense from a cost-benefit perspective. And our trees, I have to say, pretty happy. We've tried to do some be a little bit more diverse in Uptown Normal, like with our tree plantings. And again, for those of you like in science, I mean, diversity to you is like real diversity, you know, lots and lots of different kinds of things. Diversity to us is like 4 or 5 species of trees in Uptown rather than one. And so, and that's a big deal. I mean, the landscape architects, they have like this visual, like they like the idea of things looking a certain way. It's like designing a dress or something. It's not necessarily about the biology. It's kind of about the looks, although our landscape architect was great and he went way deeper than that. But you know, you kind of, some of them like the idea of this whole street will have this kind of tree, and then this whole street will have this kind of tree, which is better than the whole Uptown having exactly one kind of tree. I show pictures from the 30s of Uptown Normal. It was just full of big mature trees, and I tell people, yeah, you know what those all were? They were elm trees, and within a span of like 5 or 10 years, every tree was dead in Uptown Normal. So, and now we're dealing with ash trees. Do you guys, are you experiencing a lot of ash tree death here? So this is bad news, because in places like Normal, where you have a pretty healthy Parks and Rec department, like, I don't know what your Parks and Rec people have been planting here for the last 30 years, but we had a pretty robust tree planting program, and we planted, like, a ton of ash trees in the last 30 years. We estimate that, like, 10% of the canopy in Bloomington Normal is ash trees. Picture your community missing 10% of its mature canopy. Like, that's bad. So we plan to never go down that road again. We plant way more diverse species now. Now, to be fair, people weren't thinking about that 30 years ago. And ash trees are great. They're beautiful. They grow quickly, but they're nice and strong. They're beautiful. Tons of shade. I mean, if it weren't for the emerald ash borer, we'd be in good shape. So I think that's really cool. I think you could look at this and think, I could plant a tree like that somewhere. We have LEED buildings, which, okay, just raise your hands. How many of you have heard of LEED? So it's kind of like the good housekeeping seal of approval that says, yes, some third party has, you know, signed off on this building being environmentally friendly based on this little menu of points that you can get. And it's really cool. I mean, it really is good. When people say that they're going to build to LEED but not actually go through the process of getting certified, which a lot of people do for good reason in that they really just don't want to spend that extra money, and budgets are tight, and I am not like belittling that decision at all. It happens all the time. But you do, having been in the room where people cost engineer their building projects, so much gets nicked away over time that like it's really hard to know without a third party coming in to sign off on it that it's really been done to the degree that you had hoped it would be done. But you know, there's a middle ground. You do your best. In Uptown, people have to build LEED. If it's a certain size building. So we actually have 3 buildings that are LEED certified right now and another one that's gonna be finished in about a month. These were the first LEED buildings outside of Chicago and Illinois. Like when we said we were gonna do a LEED building, the contracting community was like, really? Like, what is that? I mean, nobody had even heard of it. I mean, we hadn't heard of it either until we started looking into it. And the Children's Museum was the first building. And what better thing to do LEED on than a building full of kids? I mean, my favorite part about LEED, in addition to all the energy savings and conserving water, all that's really great and really important. But I love the indoor air quality part of it. I mean, you just think, we spend like 90% of our time indoors and it's completely unregulated. I mean, the EPA doesn't test the air quality of this auditorium. You know, you don't know what, but outside, you know that LA has smog problems, but you don't know what the building air quality inside is. So, you know, with LEED, you're doing things like using less toxic materials and like even just during construction, like let's say the truck brings in all of your ductwork that's going to go through the whole building. Your whole ventilation system, all your ductwork is sitting there on the floor during construction and nobody bothers to seal off the ends of it. So all that construction dust and debris is just blowing on in there for weeks at a time. And then they install the ventilation system and what are you breathing, you know? So with LEED, it's just helping you remember that, okay, you need to seal off the ends of that stuff while it's sitting there. You know, it's some of it's real common sense, but because so many people get involved in these big projects, it's like nobody's job to worry about that. So I think you get a much better product out of it at the end of the day. We're really happy with our buildings. But it's something that makes us really special. I mean, when You know, you can say Normal was the first place in the country to have a LEED requirement for private buildings. That's pretty insane. You know, I mean, we really were. We were the first. This is our new transportation center that's being built. I just put this up because it's not often that you draw the picture and then you build it and it looks the same. This is very rare. It's really cool, though. It's going to be the new Amtrak station plus City Hall on top. And the reason why this is cool is that it's part of a whole focus on transportation. Like, what is transportation going to look like in my lifetime? I'm in my 30s. Things are changing. You know, for those of you that are just about 20, just imagine. I mean, we have young people now that are getting their driver's licenses later than ever before. Like, you have an amazing amount of people who are choosing, for whatever reason, to delay getting their driver's license. I mean, when I was turning 16, I mean, the clock hit midnight and you were ready to go get your license. You know, there was no waiting around. So people are putting it off a year, 2 years, 3 years, and they're trying to figure out why, and some of it's just that kids are starting to realize that investing in a car is a really bad investment in a whole lot of ways. If you can structure your life so that you don't need the car all the time, I'm not saying it's easy, and in some places it's impossible, but there are more people are choosing to wait. And so in Normal, we're really trying to look at making the transportation mix a little better balanced. You know, we've designed only for cars for like 50 years, and frankly, a lot of people like it that way. And they get really mad when you tell them you're gonna spend a dime on something other than cars. They don't want you to slow them down. They perceive anything that's non-car driven as just an obstacle. But we are just taking the position that there are a lot of reasonable things you can do to accommodate all sorts of different kinds of transportation, especially in places where people are doing it anyway. I mean, motorists may not like bicycles on the road, but with 22,000 ISU students right there, we've got kids on bikes in the road all the time. And so it's not like you can just decide you're not going to let it happen. You're legally allowed to ride your bike on the street. So we just put in our first on-street bike rack, which this is being recorded, so I'm going to try to be a little bit, I'm going to try to self-censor a little bit, but let's say this was a little tempest in a teapot. This bike rack went up and like the email started flying. I mean, the city manager, the mayor, it was like they got a couple of just vitriolic emails about how this was the ugliest thing they'd ever seen and how ridiculous that it was taking up two motorcycle spaces on the street. And after all this money we spent in Uptown Normal, why would we put this piece of junk out here? And it's too big and the bars are too far apart and who designed this? And, you know, I had to say, well, it was a company out of Minnesota that does nothing but design bike racks, but I'm pretty sure that they measured the space between the bars. But so there was this little like mini campaign like against the bike rack. It was like, down with the bike rack. And it's good when people can really like focus their anger on something like a bike rack. It brings people together. It's community building. So then the young people got onto this and they were ticked off because they love the bike rack. And so they started this like counter attack on Facebook. It was just really crazy. And all that said, honestly, it is really important that you communicate with your local elected officials, because those people hear from the same people over and over again, and it is overwhelmingly negative. And so if you don't make time to tell them good job every now and again, you know, things won't go your way, because the people who hate what they're doing are very vocal about it. And so it's like the silent majority thing. Don't be the silent majority, be the vocal majority. Start a Facebook page. No. But so it just turned out recently, this is a little tangent, but so like to promote bikes, we're just trying to do positive things. Like, we're not trying to like ruin people's lives. We're not trying to be in everyone's face. I'm not calling for some critical mass ride where we intentionally slow down traffic. I mean, we're just trying to do positive things, because there's tons of positive stuff to be done. Like, you can just wait till later to get all mad. So we had a movie at the Normal Theater called With My Own Two Wheels. Super nice little documentary, 45 minutes long, made by some master's candidates at Berkeley, I think, just some other do-gooders. I love do-gooders. And this movie is charming. It just talks about how refurbished bikes that are sent around the world to people in need change people's lives. So the movie is like about a guy in Africa who now can reach many more villages in the course of a day to provide health care. About girls in India who otherwise would have had to drop out of school in eighth grade, but now that they have a bike, they can safely zip there, zip back, and still help with all the family chores. They're going to get an education. About people in South America who are using bike parts to like grind their corn. How cool is that? So I told my friend who's a high school teacher, I was like, Kevin, you got to get your kids to come, because like, if people don't show up for this, I'm going to have a heart attack, because this took so much time to organize this. So I don't care. Give them extra credit. Tell them to come. So these kids came to the movie. They were so inspired. They started riding their bikes to Normal Community High School. It's a terrible bike ride. I mean, this is not a fun, beautiful, like picturesque ride. It stinks. Totally stinks. And they are doing it on principle because they were so jazzed about this movie. And then they find out that the bike rack was under attack, and they just like mobilized and had a meeting at the bike rack. And but the great thing is that like they weren't going to have Miss 37-year-old mom with two kids tell them they should ride their bikes to school. In fact, the last time I asked a group of high school kids this in January, I was teaching a class, and I said, how many of you would ride your bike to high school? They laughed at me. Laughed. Which I took it okay. I don't mind being laughed at. But here we are 3 months later, and they're riding their bikes. And the guy who is organizing it is cute, and he plays football. And I believe there's a small contingent of bike riders who are actually following him. But there are also all sorts of other kids who are not. They are just totally excited about this. And you know what? It's because they decided on their own. Like, they decided they had good enough reasons, and now they love it. They say they feel so good when they get to school, and they're saving all this money on their gas. Mm-hmm. So it's like change is happening, and all it took was this one random movie I decided to help show at the Normal Theater. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't have visions of grandeur here. And maybe this will totally fall apart when this guy graduates. I mean, I'm hoping they hold him back. He doesn't need to graduate on time. But I'm trying, you know, they got to incorporate some sophomores and juniors to keep it going. But, you know, it's like you do a little thing every now and again. You just never know who you're going to affect. Like, you really don't know. So you just got to keep doing it. And so, yeah, we've been doing other things, and, you know, it's like all this stuff, it probably makes us look like we're doing more than we are. And that's where I hesitate, too, because as somebody who's been really committed to sustainability for my whole life, pretty much, I'm so, like, overly critical of the town's efforts, because I feel like we're not doing nearly enough, nearly fast enough. And then I go places, and I get all this, like, oh, you guys are, like, leading the way, and you're this shining light. And I think, oh, my gosh, I wish we were doing so much more, you know? But you just gotta, like, take it easy. I mean, you can't do everything, and you have to give people their props. I mean, again, these elected officials, they can only do so much at once. I mean, they can only care about a handful of issues at a time, because there's so much information coming at them all the time. So like, you can't be too hard on them either. You just got to keep kind of shoving it their way, making it easy to digest, present it in a way that makes sense. Being confrontational is rarely the way to go. You know, everyone goes through their phases. When I was in college, I was like sending angry letters to Mitsubishi because they were doing something in the Gulf of Mexico that affected whales. You know what I mean? Like, you just, and that's fine. You go through, all that stuff is important, but like at some point, focusing on what you can do locally, it does make a lot of sense. I mean, because you know these people. I mean, you know, local, because you kind of get beyond politics too, because you can argue about whether or not the federal government should have so much control over local decision making, but like, local people should have a lot of control over local decisions. So like, it's kind of okay. You can kind of get past some of the like political nonsense and just talk about the reality, because we're all living here. I've been doing a lot with bikes and ped stuff, and it's just been so fulfilling and fun. Okay, who in here rides a bike on any regular basis? Oh, that's just great. That's great. Don't you feel so good when you get on your bike? Oh yeah, I know. It's funny too, because like, some of you guys are not old yet, but like, let me tell you, I am getting old, and I feel young when I get on my bike. You feel like, you know what? Your body works. Like, you should be able to ride a bike till you're 80, 85 years old. If you need a little step through bike, you could do that. But in the meantime, like, you need to like stay in touch with how good you're feeling. So, hey, I hit blank. It really worked. It went blank. That was an accident though. So anyway, so yeah, lots of bike riding in my life. Local food. There's a lot to be done with local food, and I think colleges are a great place for that. You guys are, there'd be a lot that you could do here. We're trying to get a grocery store co-op started in Normal, which would be super fun and good for the farmers. We just started a community garden. For years, people have been asking for a garden in Normal, and they've been told no. Not for bad reasons. It's just one more thing for the Parks and Rec people to do, and they're already very busy people. I mean, you know, don't get me wrong. But for whatever reason, this kind of caught on this year. We did a big community-wide sustainability plan, which was a great thing to do. Talk to people for a year. At the end of it all, you write up a report. You've actually accomplished something, you know, because you've met people, you've built relationships. You know, it's really good. So I was able to use the sustainability plan and say, hey, a lot of people said a community garden would be a good thing. And then all of a sudden it like, well, if 100 people said that over the course of a year, maybe it's a good idea. So we had we started our garden this year. We sold out in 2.5 hours, 35 plots. Feeling pretty good about that. And I thought, well, if we're starting a garden, it should just be organic. Like, end of story. And some people thought that was insane. And I was like, you know, we farmed organic. We had an organic farm, and we farmed like 5 acres of diverse vegetables for 8 years. If I can keep that weeded with a few farmhands, my husband and our child labor, you can do your 10 by 10 plot. Like, don't even talk to me about needing 7, because I'm not going with that. Or you can control your bugs. It's just not that big of a deal. So I am very unsympathetic about the not organic argument at that scale. And you know what's really funny? A lot of the people who sign up for the garden are very much as passionate about it as me. And when they find out that somebody else might want to do something, they're like, that's not what we signed up for. Like, I'm bringing my kids out here, and I don't expect 7. I don't expect it to be chemicals, synthetic chemicals. So it's actually going really well. It's really fun. And we meaning someone other than me, the Parks and Rec guys, built a handicap accessible plot. We're so excited. It's a raised bed, and it is going to be used by the Mark Foundation, which works with developmentally disabled adults. So that's like probably the coolest thing. So yeah, we're getting all this like, all these accolades right now are getting like little awards and big awards, and then, you know, the Mitsubishi ad. Who saw a commercial? The Mitsubishi commercial on TV. Okay, I'm just going to show you this right now for the two of you who saw it. That was me. That was me in the commercial. I was waving. I'm like famous for my wave. Yeah, it's funny how many people called me and they're like, was that the back of your head? God, my hair is so plain. Like, why would you notice my, you know, the back of my head? But yeah, it was crazy. They filmed their whole national campaign was based in Normal, Illinois last year, which is completely crazy and amazing. And like, you can't buy that kind of coverage. I mean, that's an advertising campaign put together by like the top minds of advertising. So we've benefited greatly from that. But is it always easy? No, it is not. Not even in Normal. We can talk about this. I'm going to stop because we need at least 15 minutes to talk amongst yourselves and ask questions. We have had the chicken debacle, the bike rack debacle, and I'm working on the front yard garden debacle, although this is my own front yard garden. Let me just tell you that when you move in from the county, there it is amazing how fussy people can be about certain things, and I get all sorts of calls because I work in inspection. So people call me all the time and say things like, my neighbor has just put up an ugly playset for their kids. Is that legal? I'm like, well, yeah, I mean, it is. I mean, we don't all, you know, my neighbor's kids leave their bikes all over the front yard. Is that legal? You know, I don't like the way their fence looks. I don't like this. And it's really hard when you're living close together. People have a lot of opinions, you know. And so we dug this up because, you know, there's just not enough room in the backyard for my husband. And so one day he decided to dig it up, and he says it's going to be a French garden. It's going to be beautiful. It's 4 squares with a circular feature in the center. And so I was all in. Although all my coworkers and inspections were like, you're totally going to get a phone call about your own yard. So I was like walking through the office a couple weeks ago, and I see this woman. She kind of looks familiar out of the corner of my eye. I keep walking, and I hear her say, is it legal to have a front yard garden in Normal? And I turn, and I'm like, Nancy, it's my next door neighbor. She's come in to complain about me. And I don't think she knew I worked there. Very sweet people. They're big gardeners too, but they're just of the mind and of the generation, like, you keep your garden in the backyard. And so I had to explain to her that in fact it is legal, but that we plan to make it beautiful, and that it was gonna be flowers and herbs and vegetables and not like trellises and tomato cages and stuff. Although, you know, and I don't think she bought it, but she's very nice, so she let me talk. And then my husband, I had to send him over to be the ambassador to the other neighbors. I was like, Bill, you gotta go talk to Cleta at least. I mean, she lives across the street, and she's in her 70s. So Bill went over, and he showed her all these beautiful pictures, and he's like, we were watching the Tour de France last year, and there are all these beautiful gardens over there, and they're very manicured, and this, and he's showing her all these pictures, and finally she goes, why are you telling me this? And he said, well, because I wanted to make sure you were okay with the garden I'm doing in the front yard. And she said, oh, it's your own yard. Do whatever the hell you want with it. So we had Cleta's stamp of approval. And then Sandra next door, she said, well, I just think it's cool. So the opinions are all over the board, but it's the kind of thing you run into where this would be the sustainable thing, to grow as much food as you can in your yard, but like it's not always what everybody expects your yard to look like. And same thing, you know, you go to Madison and there's vegetables growing in a plot right by the courthouse, the state capitol. I mean, can you imagine that here in Illinois? I mean, there's no way. I mean, people would not see that as a responsible aesthetic decision on public property. So, you know, you think some of this stuff makes a lot of sense, but it can be really tricky. So that's really it. I mean, it's, you know, it's such a small group. It's like, you know, church, everybody's in the back. So, but if you want to talk amongst yourselves or ask any questions, that's great. That's all I have. What's going on here in Eureka or at your school that you like? Like, what's fun? There's a prairie planting, isn't there? At Eureka, there's a prairie, isn't there? Prairie, where is it? Yeah, that happens. You need to just burn it. Well, there you go. I like that. Now, do you get any sort of weird pushback or support from like your like donors, alumni? Because I know you'll run into that too, where like, well, we can't just go on natural on campus, because then when the donors come back, they're like, ah. Do you get any sense of whether they like it or don't like it that you're allowed to say without getting fired? Okay. Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. Well, we actually, early on, we do an annual survey where we ask people just all sorts of questions about how they like living in Normal. Do you think the police are good? Do you like the library? Blah, blah, blah. And so then I was like so idealistic. And I said, you should put a question in there about what they think about the town using chemicals for weeds. And like, of course, we had several people that said, you don't spray nearly enough. So I thought, I'm never putting that question in there again. Because we will. You're not going to get phone calls from people who call and say, I'm so glad you're not using chemicals anymore. What you will get is the phone call that's like, you need to come spray because the park that's next to my backyard, I'm going to get all those dandelions in my yard. So, I mean, it's really hard, you know. Nice. That's good. Uh-huh. Yeah. That's really cool. We don't have too much of that. Oh, Heartland College, Community College, is doing a ton with that. And then, do you know they put up a wind turbine? Have you seen this thing? I mean, it's a big utility scale. I was kind of wondering if anyone would mind. I mean, it's in town, although it's on the edge. I mean, nobody said anything. It's big. And, you know, that's its whole own debate. I mean, wind power, I mean, there's all sorts of... We just need to use less energy. I think we can all agree with that. Right. We have a mayor and council, yeah. Totally part-time, yeah. Yes. He is not a mortician, but he could be, in theory, yes. So they're all part-timers. The mayor is no more special than the council members, except he does end up just having more of a voice, a little bit more public presence, because he is the only mayor, so the media tends to go to him for things. This current mayor does a lot more than any other mayor has maybe even had the ability to do, because he owns his own bike shop, and so he's been able to be a lot more flexible in giving of his time. But he makes something crazy, like $12,000 a year. You know, they all do. They all make like, he makes like 10 or 12, and they make like 6. I mean, it's a pittance for what they do. But he doesn't have any special vote. He just votes like the rest of them. So it's a total of 7, including the mayor, and he just votes like anybody else. And the city manager is, yeah, he's my boss. I work for him. I don't work for the council. They can't, like, fire me. They can pressure him to fire me, but they haven't done that yet. Maybe they will after they see this. No. Let's hope not. But it's great. I work for very visionary people. That's you know, the other thing, like, I can't emphasize enough. I did not, like, sweep into, you know, City Hall one day and turn the world upside down. I mean, there was a lot of luck showing up when I did. Now that said, I took advantage of what was going on, and I really try to advocate in the nicest way possible for things that I really think should happen. If I worked for a city manager who had none of the same interests as me, or even were antagonistic towards it, it would be very hard. I mean, it would be a different story. So I am working in an environment that's at least supportive. I mean, and I'm spoiled. It's my only real job. I've never really worked anywhere else. So I kind of, on some level, I think, isn't this just how it happens? But I mean, no, the answer is no. This is not normal, or it is normal, but not regular. I'm sorry. I didn't grow up in normal, and I still can't get past that. Like, it's just so weird to have a name of normal. Like, it makes conversation difficult. You tell people, like, well, he's the normal mayor or the normal council, and people, it just, to everyone else, it sounds crazy. So, you know, we do what we can. Yeah, we're doing a lot with electric vehicle stuff. We, you know, we have Mitsubishi's only North American manufacturing facility. So it's the only one in North America. So we've always had a special relationship with Mitsubishi. We've always tried to keep a strong tie with them and make sure that they know how much we love them because they're a great corporate citizen and employer. Well, we knew that they had an electric vehicle in the works in R&D for all these years, and we knew it was rolling out in Japan and Europe. And we wanted to make sure that, and then we also knew other manufacturers were doing the same thing. So a bunch of community leaders got together, kind of the mayor brought them together and just talked about, you guys, do you think it's for real this time? Is this like the real electric vehicle deployment? Like, are we there? And it just makes so much sense, like dollars and cents. Like, it's like you just cost it out. I mean, to drive an electric vehicle 80 miles, it costs like $1.80 in electricity. And to drive the same, like a vehicle that has like 35 miles per gallon, pretty reasonably efficient car, it costs like $7.90 or something at like $3.89 a gallon. I mean, so just the dollar thing works out great. I mean, there's all sorts of issues with, like, is it really that much more environmentally friendly when we're getting so much of our electricity from coal and all that? But, and that's a real, I'm not dismissing it, but we, you know, the community leaders decided, yes, we really want to pursue this. So we used a chunk of our energy block grant money that we got from the federal government, like everybody, all big municipalities did. And we bought a bunch of charging stations, and we've deployed them all over the community. We've given some away to private businesses as long as they make them available to the public. So we, in the next like month, we'll have 50 charging stations all around the community. And that's really helpful. I mean, even though most people, if they buy an electric vehicle, they're gonna just plug it in at night, like a cell phone or something. They're just gonna charge while you're sleeping. You know, you don't generally need a charging station like when you go to Ann Taylor Loft. I mean, you don't have to like, oh, I'll plug in for, you know, half an hour. I mean, but it does make people feel comfortable. Like they, you know, you look at Europe and Japan, they can show you maps. Like as soon as you install a publicly available charging station, the sales of EVs around it for a certain distance like goes up because suddenly people feel like, oh, that's a real thing. And there's that, they call it range anxiety, that you like, you just need to know that if you were just down to the last, not drop, whatever it is, the last little electron, that you could stop somewhere and juice your car up really quick. But so we know it's important, and that's why we're doing it. But we're pretty much done. After these 50 get in, like we're, it's a lot of public education. And the town bought 6 of its own, so we're driving 6 of them around. Super fun. Does anybody in here have one, any sort of electric car? I work with a guy who got a Volt, and then I have a friend who has a Leaf. I have a piece of junk old Corolla, and all I do is ride my bike. And I rent a car when I go out of town on the weekend. But they're really great. They're really fun to drive. It's a real car. That was the other thing. We got a couple of loaner leased cars about a year ago because we knew it was going to be really important for people to be able to get in the car and drive it, because people had this like misconception that it's kind of like a big toy or like a golf cart. And it's not. It's a real car. I mean, you hit the accelerator, you know, it goes really fast. You know, it's not like, doesn't have a governor on it. So that was crucial. I mean, every single person who drove it was like, that was really fun. And it's like a real car. Like, of course it's a real car. So it's been pretty cool. I mean, you know, it's not the solution to all of life's problems either. Like I tell people, you know, if it just means we're all going to get an electric car and just keep driving alone, well, then we still have to build all the roads. We're still going to have traffic jams. We just won't have the tailpipe emissions, you know, but it still screws up all your infrastructure. So anything else? Yes, Renee. I did say that, yeah. It was remarkably easy, and I wonder if there wasn't an element of it just kind of being kind of moved along kind of with some other things that were going on at the same time. And it wasn't controversial in the same way. And there weren't the same like forces out there. Like right now with some of the really strong anti-government stuff, like that really wasn't in play so much in 2002, three. I mean, it just wasn't the same atmosphere. And so the lead idea was explained to them and it seemed to make sense. And there wasn't some strong reaction against it. So it passed. Now, we later, years later, tried to put it in place along another part of town where there wouldn't be any financial incentives to people. Because like in Uptown Normal, all the biggest buildings are getting some sort of public assistance, whether they're getting a free land or, you know, because it's a big redevelopment project. So it's a lot easier to tell somebody you're going to make them do something if you're also giving them something. But in this other part of town, it wasn't like that. It was just a requirement. And it was only in place for about 8-10 months. And I wouldn't recommend it. I mean, it's the whole shoving water up a hose. I mean, if someone does not want to do LEED, it's just complicated. What are you going to do? Like, they build the whole thing, they move in, the building is fully occupied, and then 6 months later, you get the notice from the Green Building Council that they didn't get their LEED certification. I mean, what are you going to do? Like, kick them out of the building? You know, there's so many. If you don't have buy-in and other leverage, it's just really, that's not a battle I'd want to fight all the time. I got other things to do, so. Eureka is so lovely, though. When I came here today, my coworker said, that is my favorite small town because it is so beautiful. And we loved living near here. So take advantage while you're here. There's a lot you can do. Yeah, we're just down the street, too. If you're ever in Normal, you can just come see me and I'll take you on a tour. We can dangle our feet in the not purified water. It's true. I give people tours all the time. And then I tell my boss I'm working. See ya, giving a tour.